A hushed silence. He was very excited. There was a performer in the 1940s that you will never have heard of. He was called Tommy Trinder. And before every performance he ever made, this was in the days when theatres had curtains, he would just shove his head through the middle of the curtains and say, "You lucky people!" And I sort of want to say that a bit tonight. I don't really like making speeches before performances, because if you do that before school plays and school concerts, then all the professionalism that goes into is sort of somehow wiped out, because it seems, oh, it's just a school play. But occasionally there are times that you do have to say quite important things. And it isn't to point out where the emergency exits are. They're there. But actually, I just want you to take a moment and think about the fact that we're in the second day of our fifth week back since the start of the term. There has already been a performance in here 2 weeks ago. The 15 drama scholars that you're about to see have literally been working their socks off for the last 2.5 weeks, and as parents of some of them, you will know how hard that they have been working. I'm immensely proud of them. This is one of the best evenings of the year, really, for performing arts, because the second half, the music will absolutely knock your socks off. Your jaws will be on the floor. But I have to say, I'm hugely proud of the next 45 minutes. When we finish our first half, the cast will lead you from the theatre to Ralph Hall, where there will be a refreshment for you, a drink, please imbibe, and then my colleague, Mr. McKelvey, will welcome you to Ralph Hall. I hope you have a fantastic, fantastic 45 minutes, a brilliant drink, and an even better 45 minutes in Ralph Hall. And that might be tricky, because they're very good. Thank you very much.
Donald O'Gadavran, your way is a thorny way. Your last state is worse than your first. Oh, me alas, pain ever, forever, like thee, Prometheus. No change, no pause, no hope. A life, life, life. Another fury come to plague me now. You cannot till you're tired.
Are you in, Mr. Shields?
No, he's not, Minnie. He's just gone out. If you run out quickly, you're sure to catch him.
Oh, it's all right, Mr. Davin. You'll do just as well. I just come in for a jap and milk, for a cup of tea. I shouldn't be troubling you this way, but I'm sure you don't mind.
No trouble in the world. Delighted, I'm sure. There, would that be enough?
Plenty lashings, thanks. To be all alone all the day, Mr. Davin.
No, indeed. I wish to God I was.
Can't be good for you, then.
No.
I don't know how you like to be by yourself. I couldn't stick it long.
No.
No, indeed. There's nothing I'm more fond of than a hooly. I was at one last Sunday. I danced rings around me. Tammy Owens was there. You know Tammy Owens, don't you?
I can't say how you do.
Do you not? The little fellow that lives with his mother in the shoe pair back. Oh, he's a gorgeous melodeon player.
A gifted son of Orpheus, eh?
You said it, Mr. Davrin. The son of poor old Batty Owens. A wee, she darny bit of a man that was never sobering. Always talking politics. Poor man. Killed him in the long run.
A man should always be drunk, Minnie, when he's talking politics. It's the only way in which to make him important.
Tommy takes after the old fellow, too. He talks from morning till night when he has a few jars in him. Poetry is a grand thing, Mr. Davrin. I'd love to be able to write a poem. A lovely poem in Ireland, and the men of 98.
We've had enough of poems about 98, and of Ireland too.
Well, there's a thing for a Republican to say, but I know what you mean. It's time to give up the writing and take to the gun!
What's Mr. Shields doing with your weeds?
Those aren't shields, they're mine. Wild flowers is a kindlier name than weeds. These are wild violets. This is an arum maculatum, or wake robin. And this is a celandine, a very beautiful flower, closely related to the buttercups. One day when morn's half-opened eyes were bright with spring sunshine, my hands were clasped in yours, dear love, and yours were clasped in mine. We bowed as worshippers before the golden celandine.
Oh, aren't they lovely, Anne? Isn't the poem lovely too?
I wonder now who she was.
She? Who?
Well, oh, be the way you don't know.
No, I'm sure I don't know.
Doesn't matter anyhow. That's your own business. I suppose I don't know her.
Know her? Know whom?
Her! Whose hand was clasped in yours and, oh, yours was clasped in hers.
Oh, that. That was simply a poem I quoted about the celandine. That might apply to any girl. To you, for instance.
But you have a sweetheart all the same, Mr. Davern, haven't you?
I? No, not one minute.
You can tell that to someone else. Aren't you a poet, and aren't all the girls fond of poets?
That may be, but only the poets aren't fond of girls.
They are in the storybooks. I am fond of more than one, too. Are you fond of them, Mr. Davern?
Of course I'm fond of girls, Minnie. Especially those who can add to their charms in the way that they dress, like you, for instance.
Oh, now you're on for a con in me, Mr. Davern.
No, I'm serious. You're a very charming little girl indeed.
Well, then, if I'm a charming little girl, you ought to be able to write a poem about me.
And so I will, Minnie, so I will. I've written poems about girls not half as pretty as yourself.
Oh, I knew you had one. I knew you had one now.
Nonsense. Not every poet a girl has written in is his sweetheart. Annie Laurie wasn't the sweetheart of Bobby Burns.
You needn't tell me she wasn't. And for bonny Annie Laurie, I'd lay me down and die. No man would lay down and die for any but a sweetheart, not even for a wife.
No man, Minnie, willingly dies for anything.
Except for his country. Like Robert Emmet.
Even he would have lived on if he could. He died not to deliver Ireland. The British government killed him to save the British nation.
You're only joking me now. You'd die for your country.
I'm not so sure about that.
Oh, you would! I know what you are.
What am I?
A gunman on the road.
Maybe I am. Maybe I'm not.
Oh, I know. Do you ever be afraid?
Afraid? Afraid of what?
The ambush, of course. I'm all of a trembling when I hear a shot go off it. What must it be in the middle of the firing?
I'll admit, one does be a little nervous at first. But a man gets used to it after a while, till at last a gunman throws a bomb, as carelessly as a schoolboy throws a snowball.
I wish it was all over all the same. You'll take care of yourself, won't you? Won't you, Don? I mean, Mr. Davern.
Call me Donald, Minnie. We're friends. Great friends now. Go on, call me Donan. Let me hear you say Donan.
The place badly needs a tidying up. Donal, there, now you're satisfied.
But it really does. It's in an awful state.
Tomorrow's a half day. I'll run in and straighten it up a bit.
No, Minnie, you're far too pretty for that kind of work. Besides, the people of the house are sure to start talking about you.
And do you think Minnie Powell cares whether they'll talk or no? She's had to push her way through life up to this without help from anyone. So she's not going to ask their leave now to do what she wants to do.
My soul within art, though, Minnie. A pioneer in action as I am a pioneer in thought. The two powers that shall grasp this scheme of sorry things entire and mould life nearer to the heart's desire. Lovely little Minnie. Brave as well. Brave little Minnie. Lovely as well.
Thank you.
abyss, Morty.
An abyss is a deep and terrible chasm.
What is a chasm?
A huge gash in the rocks.
What is it,
Ava? Sew on your buttons now. Show me that you can do it.
I can't get the thread through the needle. It's too thick.
You do it.
Lick the thread.
Do I have to?
Yes, lick the thread.
But I don't want to sew.
How else will the buttons get onto the coat?
The coat is too big for me.
It's to last next winter too.
Please?
No.
Why won't you help me?
Because you have to be able to manage on your own.
Why?
Because you do. Now, lick the thread. That should flatten it, and hold the needle firmly, and place the end of the thread between your fingers. Not too near. That's it. See? You don't need me. It's good. I don't mind having my coat open a bit. Really, I've got enough buttons.
You'll miss it when the wind blows.
Can't I do it later?
There is no later left, Ava.
After the packing, after my story.
Now.
Most of it is junk.
You don't keep junk.
Do you want anything in particular?
Not really.
Pants? What, all those? Are you intending to cook or eat raw?
I was thinking takeaways.
Have them.
What else?
Lights, cutlery, crockery. There's a television somewhere.
You sound like a shop assistant trying to make a sale.
Just don't be a difficult customer. I told Mum we wouldn't be long. Would cups and saucers be of any use?
I prefer mugs.
What about for visitors?
Well, they can have mugs too.
I'll give you the set just in case.
Mum,
and here's a spare teapot too.
I'm not going to need two teapots.
One might break.
You don't have to do this.
Who else is going to?
Dad sent me another shirt.
Would you use a strainer?
Not really.
I thought you were meant to be saving that money.
You wouldn't mind me spending it.
That's not what we agreed originally.
Well, I'm not 14 anymore.
I see.
I'd just like to buy some of my own things.
I thought you approved of my taste.
Well, I do. Your things are beautiful.
I'm glad to hear it.
You should keep them.
They should be used rather than left to mortar in a box. Glasses.
Those must be worth a fortune.
Nothing is too good for my daughter.
Might be too good for the flat.
You said you and your friends were very happy with this one.
Well, the rent's so high for what it is.
You said it was a bargain.
Maybe you should have come to see it.
You are quite capable of choosing a place to live without my help.
Maybe it's not such a good idea to move. I don't feel right about it.
This is broken.
What do you think about waiting? Until I can afford to buy somewhere.
I think if you say you are going, you should go.
Oh, I can get the deposit back.
What, like you got the deposit back last
time?
That
was different.
It sounds remarkably similar to me.
I'm just not sure that I like it.
Oh, Faith, for heaven's sake, you are impossible.
Well, if you'd come to see it, you'd know.
How did this glass get so damaged? I put in enough paper.
Oh, I don't like leaving you on your own.
Tablecloths.
Are you angry?
Absolutely not.
Are we still friends?
Of course.
I don't want to go.
Will five glasses be enough?
Oh, you can forget about the glasses!
You'll need something to drink from in your new home.
Why aren't Carla and Heinrich going on one of the trains?
Their parents couldn't get some places.
Carla said it's because they didn't want to send them away.
Carla says a lot of silly things.
Why is that silly?
Of course they would send them away if they had places. Any good parent would want that.
Why?
Because any good parent would want to protect their child. Matthew and Vati protect me? Only by sending you away.
But why will I be safer with strangers?
Your English family will be kind.
They don't know me.
Ava. This is for the best.
Will you miss me?
Of course I will.
Will you write to me?
Ava, I will do more than miss you and write to you. Vati and I will come. We will not let you leave us behind for very long. Do you think we would really send you away if we thought we would never see you again?
How long will it be before you come?
Only a month or two, when the silly permits are ready.
Silly permits?
Silly, silly permits.
The needle stuff. Finish it off for me.
Why are you taking that?
A broken glass is forever ruined.
Try to meet other Jews in England.
I will.
Say, don't mind who's there. It's like it was here when I was younger. It'll be good.
When you and Vati come, will Vati get his proper job back like he used to have?
I'm sure he will.
Finished.
Come in. Ah, good. I see you have been running.
Yes, sir.
There is a queue at the chemist's, I suppose.
Yes, sir.
And doubtless an even longer one at the steward's.
Yes, sir. Oh, I mean, no, sir. I mean...
I was late myself, and for that I apologise.
Oh, well, that's quite all right.
Luckily, we still have a good hour before lock-up, so nothing has been lost. I understand you are desirous of obtaining a remove from my form so that you can spend the rest of your career happily playing with the bunts and burners, retorts and crucibles of the science fifth.
Have I, sir?
Have you what?
Have I obtained a remove, sir?
You have obtained exactly what you deserve, no less, and certainly no more. Line 1300... And 99, begin.
Chorus, we are surprised at...
We marvel at...
We marvel at thy tongue, how bold thou art that you...
Thou...
Thou canst...
Canst...
Canst boastfully speak...
Utter such a boastful speech...
Utter such a boastful speech... Over the bloody corpse of the husband you have slain.
Taplow, I presume you have a different text from mine.
No, sir.
That is strange. The line as I has it reads, Hetus Hagen Logon. And however diligently I search, I can discover no bloody, no corpse, no you have slain. Simply husband.
Yes, sir, that's right, sir.
Then why do you invent words that are simply not there?
Well, I thought they sounded better, sir. More exciting, as you will. After all, she did just kill her husband, sir. And she's just been revealed with his dead body. And Cassandra is weltering in gore.
I am delighted at this new evidence, Taplow, of your interest in the rather more learned aspects of dramaturgy.
However, I feel I must remind you that you are meant to be conscrewing Greek, not collaborating with Aeschylus.
Yes, but still, sir. Translator's license, sir. I didn't get anything wrong, and after all, it is a play, sir. Not just a bit of Greek construe.
I seem to detect a note of end of term in your remarks. I am not denying that the Agamemnon is a play. It is perhaps the greatest play ever written.
I wonder how many people in your form think that. I am sorry, sir. Shall I go on, sir? Shall I go on, sir?
When I was a very young man, only 2 years older than you are now, Taplow, I wrote a translation of the Agamemnon. A very free translation, I remember, with rhyming couplets.
The whole Agamemnon? In verse? That must have been hard work, sir.
It was hard work, but I derived great joy from it. The play so excited and moved me that I wished, however imperfectly, to share some of that emotion with others. When it was finished, I thought it beautiful, almost more beautiful than the original.
Was it ever published, sir?
No. I tried to find the manuscript while I was packing my papers, but I fear it is lost, like so many other things, lost for good.
Hard luck, sir. Shall I go on, sir?
No. Go back and get that last line right.
Thou canst utter such a boastful speech over thy husband.
Yes. Now, if you'd be so kind, you would do it again, without the facial contortion that you found so necessary to accompany it.
Chorus. We are surprised at, we marvel at thy tongue. How bold thou art.
Close and curling.
His eyebrows are dark and arched. His eyes seem strange, awfully. The only thing I can remember clearly is that they're small and very fixed. His mouth is wide, his lips are thin. He has a long, pale face. He's tall, erect, well-dressed, but certainly not a gentleman.
A gentleman? Not he.
You know him?
Quint.
Quint.
Peter Quint. His own man. His valet when the master was here. And the master died. Quint was alone.
Alone?
Alone with us. In charge.
And then?
He went.
Went where?
God knows where. He died.
Doing this. You looked as though you were pushing something away.
Flora, sit down.
Oh, look! There's a bird with an enormous worm. Mayn't we go out?
Certainly not. It's raining.
No, it isn't. It's dripping from every twig and leaf and branch.
Will you sit down?
Why, of course.
Oh, Miles, your pencil does have a terrible squeak.
I can't help it, you know.
Can't you? I thought you were doing it on purpose. I wish I could. Oh, dear.
Now what's the matter?
It's my pencil.
You should have bent down on it so. Here's another.
Just the squeak of Miles' pencil sends shivers through you. It does through me.
No. Listen. I know it's a horrible day, but could you try to do your task quietly, dear?
Does your head hurt, Miss Giddens? Oh, Miles, poor Miss Giddens.
Flora, dear, my head doesn't hurt.
Doesn't it? You feel warm. Miles, I do believe Miss Giddens has a fever.
Has she? May I get you a cup of tea, Miss Giddens, or a plaster?
A plaster? Whatever for? I'm not ill, you dear thing. The rain, and not being able to go out into the garden, and tiring my eyes with this.
Then why do you bother about it, if you don't like it?
It's my task for the day, like your spelling and geography, though nothing seems to be getting done while we go on about nothing.
It's the rain that does it. I know, because I'm all turned about when I wake up and find the sun isn't out.
I know! I get a funny feeling that something's going to happen. I waited all day. It never ever does. It's so disappointing,
what with having to stay in. You're not going out.
Not even with a hat.
Not even with a hat!
Don't keep on at Miss Skinner's like that. We must do as she wishes, you know.
Of course we must. I'm being naughty, aren't I?
No, it's I who am behaving wickedly. What a grumpy old governess you have.
You're not grumpy at all. Is she, Miles?
Of course she isn't, though I wouldn't wonder if she were.
Nor would I. With everything so horrible.
Horrible?
Why, yes. You know, the rain, Miles' squeaky pencil, and my naughtiness. Why, I wasn't even trying to be good.
But you are good. You both are.
Well, I might try a little harder, don't you think?
Why, no. It's gloomy outside. There's no reason why we should be gloomy in here. Let's play.
Play?
Of course. You can choose the game.
Hide and seek!
No!
I'm sorry. You said I could choose the game.
Oh, I did. I did, and you may. But let's not hide from each other. Mrs. Grice has dusted and tidied all morning, and it wouldn't be kind of us to mess it all up again now, would it? And what's the fun of hide and seek if you can't pull apart the beds and hide in the cupboards?
Then you finishes the game.
I shall.
Laura, dear, Hart has an idea.
Dressing up.
Dressing up, that's a wonderful game. Dressing up. I can remember dressing up with my brothers and sisters on rainy days. Why didn't I think of it? It's so much more fun than, well, anything else I can think of. Use my handkerchief, dear. Kings and queens, beggars and thieves!
May we?
Of course you may!
Come along then, Flora.
Why? Where are you going?
To dress up. Didn't you say we may?
I'll go with you.
But then you'd know what we were. There'd be no surprise.
Miss? I've let them go, Mrs. Gross. I've let them go.
Where, Miss?
Up there. I've let them go. They were with me all morning. Now I've let them go.
Set wide the window, let me drink the day.
Edith Walton,
love as a woman's whole existence.
Lords Byron. Dead posh. And a bleeding bloke. I am the only one who reads the books in this house.
Joining the war has made me whole. Oh,
my Auntie Jane joined the war effort. She works in a munitions factory.
Does she feel invigorated? Reborn?
She's got lead poisoning. How long are you staying, Miss Lids?
Couple of days of R&R until the old dog and telephone rings. The week's been a right bastard, mate. Just dropped off 3 hurricanes. I'm proper cream exhausted.
Jack Absolute is a pilot here.
Seen him, felt nothing.
Oh, gone off the fellas then, eh?
Only posh boys. Actually, I just met a right dish.
Oh, proper turned your taps on, yeah?
What? No, he's strong, brooding, covered in engine oil.
Oh, yummy.
Moustache, man of few words, all with very short vowels.
He's Norvan, with a tattoo.
You know him?
Dudley Scunthorpe, the fitter.
You do know him?
She's after my Dudley.
I can't understand much of what he says, but I'm certain we'll be happy together for the rest of our lives. Oh, how charming poverty will be with him. The wreck of wealth and the surrounding gloom of adversity will make the flame of pure love burn brighter. So, me old cocker, be a good bloke and give him this letter.
First rule of restoration comedy, never give the maid the letter. My pleasure, Miss Lee.
Lydia, Juju! Mwah! Your uniform! It's entirely brown.
It's so itchy.
Like a lovely big number two.
It's really itchy.
Lucy, come meet Miss Julia Melville, daughter of Viscount Melville of the Edinburgh Melvilles.
All right.
I am, thank you. Yes, hello.
Can I take your coat, Miss?
No, comrade. I'll take her coat. You go do something liberating, like play tennis or get a manicure. We are equals, remember?
Righto, comrade.
Gosh, Lydia, have you gone terribly left wing?
It's a brave new world, Juju. Now, what's the goals?
I'm so nervous. I just can't wait to see my Roy.
Must we always talk about boys? 2 women should be able to talk about anything they want.
Well, what do you want to talk about?
Female emancipation.
Go on, then.
As enlightened women, it is up to us to decide whether men are the problem or capitalism. That is the true dichotomy that has blocked our progress.
Yes, but it's not just economics, though, is it, Lydia? Women's freedom is also constrained by religion and cultural tradition.
He's your cousin.
Well, that's not Roy's fault, is it? I can't wait to kiss his little face, and then I'll wash his socks and fill his pipe and make him a lovely ham salad.
Can't he make his own ham salad?
He's a man, silly. And when we're married, I'll bake every day. And on Sunday, when we get back from church, I'll draw the curtains and let him do anything he wants.
If he hadn't have saved your life when the boat sank, would you still love him?
And I have to marry someone.
One doesn't marry a man just because he can swim.
We could have a joint wedding.
Then who should I marry?
Jack Absolute?
Never.
You haven't stopped talking about him since Felicity Pumpson's coming out.
That was before I read this.
The Memoirs of a Sexually Liberated Socialist Woman.
It'll change your life.
Are there some good recipes in it?
Don't be ridiculous.
Then why is there a picture of half an avocado pear?
That's not an avocado.
Oh.
You have to understand how your body works.
I was going to leave that to Roy. He's good at knots.
Oh, Julia.
it, I've got you this time.
Oh God, I thought you were Fowler.
Shh! What on earth are you doing?
Celebrating!
But I thought you didn't have to be back until tomorrow morning.
That drainpipe is a bloody disgrace. Someone should have a word with Farcical.
Shh!
Tommy. May I call you Tommy, Tommy?
If you want.
Oh, Tommy. I'm in love.
Well, that's not exactly news.
Oh, I don't mean in love. I mean in love.
You're drunk.
It's like being drunk. Only instead of things going round and round, they're perfectly, beautifully still. And not blurred. Sharp, clear, brighter colours than you've ever seen. It's unbelievable.
The wedding was a success then?
Oh, it wasn't a wedding. More an engagement party.
What?
But, oh, you mean the wedding? Oh, no, that was ghastly. Mother blood. And Arthur. Oh, he wants me to call him Arthur. Can you believe it?
Perhaps it's his name?
I told her. You may call him anything you like. He's your husband. I shall call him Colonel, and that's the
shh!
Leaving me to rot in this jail of a school while she flaunts herself up and down the Riviera with that shh! Sorry. But I mean, honestly, it's so undignified. People that age going off to Cap Ferrat. They should creep down to Cromer and count themselves lucky. Tweeds, plus fours, out on the links all day, that's what they should be doing. I told them so. Made Mother Blub again.
Cad.
But they're trying to get rid of me, Tommy. They have a world tour all set up. Cape Town, Singapore, Hong Kong, Australia, I ask you.
Really?
It's the Martineau business. They fear for my moral character.
It's a bit late for that, isn't it?
You must be mad, I said. I'm not leaving now. School's just getting to the good bit.
I didn't know there was a good bit.
Well, for you, there isn't. You're determined not to have one. But for sensible people, like me, I'm going to dress like this every day next term, Tommy.
You better be careful not to get any more food on that waistcoat, then. It's grubby already.
Damn the waistcoat. I've been waiting for this ever since my first day at prep.
How pathetic.
Nothing will be this good again until I'm ambassador in Paris.
Childish.
Life is ladders. Prepper to here. First form to sixth. Second assistant, junior undersecretary to ambassador in Paris. Ladders. And love. Oh, it's so wonderful being in love.
So you said.
I took James to dinner at the Fox and Hound.
Who's James?
Ah, Court, his name is James. His name is James.
Ugh. You're mad!
We arranged it all yesterday. If my mother was marrying Arthur. I didn't see why I shouldn't have dinner with James. He told his housemaid his uncle was coming down. I'm a fool. I should have booked a room.
Why not the bridal suite?
Oh, no, that would have spoiled it. And anyway, he had to be in by 9:30. We wouldn't have had time.
My God, you really did go.
You know, till now, it's all just been a game. Maneuvering for glances, meeting accidentally on purpose. You're simply relieving the boredom. But now...
You'll be sunk.
No,
Master's
no.
Drink at the Fox and Hounds. Bennett, you are mad.
Oh, do call me Guy. It's so stupid. Surnames. Have you ever really been in love?
No. It's...
I've been wandering about, thinking. What time is it now?
It's getting on for one.
3 hours.
Well, why didn't you just come back here?
Because I have an exeat. I'm free. I'm not really here at all. I'm in London.
Shh, for God's sake, you'll get us both beaten.
Oh, they can't beat me if I'm not here.
Shh.
I think I'll sleep here, if you don't mind.
You better not let anybody see you dressed like that. You'll get the gamut for that waistcoat.
When I'm in 22, I'll have a fag to keep it clean. Everything will be absolutely...
Oh, Tommy.
Amor vincit omnia.
You're hopeless. A totally hopeless case.
Don't worry about me. I shan't disturb you. I'm asleep already.
Do you honestly think this is wise? If you're not drunk... I really do think... Oh, well, it's nothing to do with me.
Bliss.
First, they take away my torches. Then, when I take my life, or at least my bum, into my hands and creep down here, they send me you. This place is impossible.
Good night.
Good night.
Who's the